thing on, and we're rolling.
I just wanted to give a screencast to give some insight into the learning process of a drum cover. And I've decided to try to learn Rosetta Stoned by Tool on the drums. This is by far the most requested drum cover that I get on my YouTube channel. Many of you often very subtly try to nudge me in that direction with your comments. So anytime I put up a video, I see about 10 comments with Rosetta Stoned in all caps with several exclamation points behind it. So I get the point, and I decided to finally do it. It's been on my list now for years, but it's a song that I've always really liked, but I've never fallen in love with it until recently. I mean, it's a real sleeper of a song to me. It's, you know, everybody knows it as one of the penultimate rock songs from Tool and from any rock band in the past decade or even century. And I've always liked it, but like I said, I'd never really got it, really, until just recently. So I wanted to share some of the process of learning this song. Now, I've never really scored an entire song before, except for my own songs through Portraits. You know, I scored all those, wrote those before we recorded them. But when I'm just learning drum covers, I typically learn by ear entirely, or sometimes I'll score just a small section or a drum fill. But I haven't done it entirely up until now. And the reason why I did it on this song, well, there's several reasons. Number one, song's incredibly complex and incredibly long, and I don't think I could memorize all this. It would take me a year to memorize every little detail and aspect of this song, so it's going to help me while I'm playing it to have the score in front of me for parts of it. And number two, this is one of those rare songs where Danny Carey actually has a video, or there is a video of Danny Carey playing it entirely. He played it at a drum clinic in Kansas City, I think in 2009. And there's a video of that, so you can see up close and in detail what he's doing on the drums. And that's rare for Tool songs. So that was another reason. And it's by far the most difficult Tool song that I've attempted. The most difficult song ever, not just out of Tool, but ever, which says something. I've tried some really difficult songs. So even as an avid Tool fan and as a drummer, I never really realized the complexity and the insanity of Danny Carey's drumming in this song. And it wasn't until I started breaking it down and analyzing it that it really opened my eyes. Danny is a straight barbarian. I mean, without a doubt, this drum arrangement and this particular song alone makes Danny Carey one of the best rock drummers of all time. And I don't say that lightly. Yes, there are many other drummers who I love and respect and who have created faster or even more technically complex drum parts and fills, but Danny's ability to be so creative with his orchestration and to constantly shift the phrasing throughout the song so that nothing ever gets stale, and to combine obscure rudiments and definitely obscure time signatures and insane polyrhythms. He does this and combines all these in a way that never compromises the musicality of the song. It's just amazing. And there are many drummers who can create complicated and technical grooves and fills, but in my mind, Danny is the absolute best at doing this tastefully in a way that complements the music rather than overrides it or distracts from it. So let's look at what's going on here. This is the drum notation. And for those of you who don't know drum sheet music, the center row in the musical staff here is the snare drum. The lower bar here is the kick drum. The snare drum with the circle around it is a ghost note. And then stuff up high here, above the staff, are the cymbals. So we have a crash, hi-hat, open hi-hat. And there's also ride cymbals up here too as well. And then the toms are located, the toms sandwich the snare drum. So they're right above and below the snare drum. So you get the point here. Let's listen to a bit of the first of the song here. Turn the music off there. This is programmed drum kit. I'm using just a default kit in Logic, which is the program I use. It's called the Bluebird kit, I think. Doesn't sound great. Doesn't matter what it sounds like. I'm just using it for the notation. So the first part of this song is by no means easy. I mean, we have predominantly shifting time signatures of 4/4 and 5/8 in the verses and the choruses. And you can see I also charted, the first thing I did actually was chart the tempo. And you can see the tempo fluctuates because they did not play to a click, which is just amazing. There's so many different time signature changes in the song as a whole. So we go through 5/8, 4/4. By the way, when I put most things in 8, so even when it's 4/4, I'll put it in 8/8 because I often like to hear those eighth note clicks when I'm using a click in my ear. So 4/4 is denoted as 8/8. Nevertheless, we go 5/4, 5/8, 4/4. 9/8, there's 10/8, 5/8, there's 11/8, and they did not play this to a click. Danny Carey is just a machine. He's got this going on in his head. He's keeping this beat. To do that without a click in your ear is just phenomenal. So first, it's a pain in the butt to chart because I had to go through all these fluctuations in the tempo and then chart the time signature as well. So for example, let's go to this bar 86 here and listen to some of this 9/8 madness. I mean, to keep that in your head without a click is just phenomenal. So one of the most noticeable parts, I remember the first time I listened to this song, you know, a lot of it sounded awesomely Tool on the first listen. And then there was this snare fill, which I think sticks out in a lot of people's heads. And to everybody who doesn't know better, they would think that Danny's just improvising a snare fill with a slowdown, just doing it randomly. But as always, that Danny's following a plan. He's got some math involved in there. And if you look, I've kind of notated up on top here what's going on. So he starts with straight 32nd notes and moves into 16th note triplets. By the way, this is over an a time signature of 11/8, so it's not necessarily intuitive where the break's going to be. After the 16th note triplets, they slow down to straight 16th notes, then they move into 8th note triplets, and then straight 8th notes, dotted 8th notes, and he ends on quarter notes. And, you know, like I said, it just sounds like he's just slowing down randomly, but it's all premeditated. So when I say that Danny is constantly shifting the phrasing of the music, let me try to find an example here. So let's go to bar 114. This is one of the verses. It's like the third or fourth one. And just the hi-hat pattern alone in the verses is constantly shifting. So here's, like I said, about the third verse, and look at the hi-hat pattern here. He starts opening it consistently. So let's listen to this. Alright, so that's one chorus, and you can see at the end of the chorus he's just straight kick with open hi-hats. Let's look at what he does on the next chorus. What you'll see is he alternates the open hi-hat. So instead of playing it open here and closed here, he plays it closed here and open here and does that consistently through the next one. So the next one's going to be starting about here. So that's the exact opposite of that previous verse, and then you know he's going to change it again, so right about here. Notice that kick pattern right here? Totally screws with your mind. So he's playing an 11 over 3 polyrhythm by incorporating that kick drum in here. It's real top shelf stuff, and that's we're not even halfway through the song yet. And I've been practicing this on the real kit, and I've made it here to the solo. I've gotten this far, which let's zoom out, look at the point. It's not even halfway through the song yet, and we're 5.5 minutes in, right? And this is no walk in the park. I spent hours getting up to this point in the song, and then the solo goes a little nuts for a while. Hertas and 16th note triplets over a 32nd note kick drum pattern, double bass pattern. Okay. Here's where things get extremely interesting. And this, you can call this the breakdown, I called it a hook and interlude, and there's a build. Nevertheless, this is often talked about as being the polyrhythm part of the song. So this, through the rest of the song, is where Danny Carey really shows his genius. And let's see here. Let's listen to a bit of the audio. So you can hear that he's starting to use his mandola, electronic pad there. It kind of sounds like a detuned clave. You hear that? So this is a 6-4 groove, and his hands are hitting mostly 16th notes, and then there are snare accents on every third quarter note. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So if you didn't know what Danny was doing here, it would be real easy to cheat on this groove on the drums and play a real simple right-hand diddle with alternating left-hand singles. So let me stop it here. I have a practice pad. I'm at home in my office here, so I don't have my real drum kit, but if you wanted to cheat, or if you just didn't know what Danny was doing, you would think with his hands, he was just diddling with his right hand and playing singles with his left, so something like... So again, that's just doubles with the right hand and singles with the left hand. But as always, things aren't so simple as they seem with Danny. So let's go to the video and see what he is doing. So instead of the mandola pad, he's playing that rototom with his right hand. Here's it in slow motion. So let's look at his left hand here. Those are not singles. Those are doubles, except for the snare accent on every third quarter note. So you can see what he's doing here in slow motion, and then that is his favorite rudiment, which is the Swiss Army triplet. So the Swiss Army triplet, let's back up here a little bit. The Swiss Army triplet is flam, right, left, flam, right, left. On the pad, it's flam, right, left, flam. So he's playing straight Swiss Army triplets, except he's breaking that pattern occasionally with his right hand. with his left hand, sorry, to play the accents on the snare drum. So he begins here at the very beginning of this breakdown, which I titled Bridge here. He begins by playing his right hand entirely on the mandola pad, which sounds, again, kind of like a metallic detuned clave. And on his with his left hand, he's keeping it entirely on the snare. He's playing ghost notes for all of the Swiss Army triplet parts, and then accents on three. So it sounds something like this. So let's look at the drum notation here on the screen. So you can ignore the kick and the crash for now, and the hi-hat foot stomps here. And let's just look at the snare and the tom pattern. So I've notated the mandola pad as tom one. And we have snares here, mostly in the form of ghost notes, and then accents every third quarter note. So we can look at this as being a Swiss Army triplet. So flam, right, left, flam, right, and then left for the accent, right, right. So it breaks up the pattern here when you're doing the snare accent. So it makes it a lot more difficult. Okay, so flam, right, left, flam, right, left, flam, right, left, accent. Okay, so you get the point here. It's not a simple pattern with the hands alone. And then when you throw in the kicks and the hi-hat, things become much, much more interesting. And the rest of the song is just Swiss Army triplet insanity. From here to the end of the song, Danny just absolutely rapes the Swiss Army triplet rudiment. He puts it in polyrhythms. He orchestrates it every which way, all over the kit, all over the electronic pads. So let me give you an example. So this starts out relatively simple, like I said, orchestrated with the mandola pad with the right hand and the snare on the left hand. And then it goes on for many, many measures, and then we get to a change of sorts here, what I titled the interlude. Let's listen to this. So he switches mostly to the mandola pads here, and he starts a polyrhythm. So his hands are staying in 6-4, 6/4 time signature. But if you listen to the kick drum, he's playing something funny with the kick drum. He's actually playing a 5/4 pattern with the kick drum, which makes it just insanely complex. So that repeating kick drum pattern falls everywhere. It takes 5 bars of the 6/4 time signature before this kick drum pattern begins repeating itself and falling on the one again. In those 5 bars, the kick is just all over the place. So you gotta have 2 brains basically to be playing this. And to top it off, if you listen, his left foot is just gluing everything together on quarter notes. And then this culminates in this one of the most incredible choruses of any Tool song. I mean, it's just a peak of emotion. It's fun to watch the video of Danny playing this. Let's switch over to that. You can actually see him start to get a little too emotional. He has to pull it back a little bit. He starts off just smashing those cymbals, and you can tell he has to back off a little bit. He's a big dude. He could probably just break through that entire kit if he wanted to. But if I make it this far, I don't know what's going to happen. I might fall off my drum stool, start crying. Who knows? Who knows what's going to happen? So you thought maybe Danny couldn't go anywhere else with that Swiss triplet pattern? That would be wrong. So coming up here in this hook, we'll hear that the time signature shifts to 5/4. Listen. Now, Maynard, Justin, Adam, they're all playing in 5/4 together, but Danny just continues with this same pattern he was playing in the breakdown. So he's playing in a 6/4 time signature with all that weird Swiss triplet business going on over the 5/4. So instead of playing a polyrhythm himself, he's creating the polyrhythm by playing a contrasting time signature with the rest of the band. Now listen here, the kick drum comes in right here. So the kick drum, he's playing in 5/4. Now he's playing a polyrhythm by himself, but he's matching his feet with the rest of the band, and his hands are playing in a different time signature. I mean, it's just insane. He's in another dimension. He's like Neo in The Matrix when he starts dodging the bullets. I mean, it's just nuts. So he's not even done yet. So he throws in a few more variations of the same groove over a 5/4 time signature. So you can see that the whole band is playing with these alternating 6/4 and 5/4 bars. And Danny's consistently throwing in some variations over that same groove. Okay, so this takes us to the finale. And the finale starts with what I term the collision here. And this is when Adam breaks off into this groove. So Adam's actually playing in 11/4 time signature there. I put 5/4 here because this is what the drums and Maynard are playing in. So the whole band is playing in a polyrhythm. You can see, listen to this part. This is where the drums and Maynard come in. One, two, three, four, five. So they're playing in a 5/4 over 11/4 to create the polyrhythm in the band. And then you can bet Danny's going to start working his wizardry here. Let's listen. So he's playing here that same Swiss Army triplet pattern with his hands. And he's playing that in a 5/4 time signature. Let's listen to it again. So I should say the kick drum stays in 5/4, and when he starts playing the Swiss Army triplets, he's playing those in 6/4. So to recap, Adam, the guitarist, is playing in 11/4. Maynard is singing in 5/4. Danny Carey's right foot is playing in 5/4. Danny Carey's hands are playing in 6/4. Danny Carey's left foot is gluing everything together in quarter notes. They're playing in three different time signatures here. It's impossible. And then Danny Carey throws in that fill at the end just for icing on the cake. I mean, to use another movie metaphor, does anybody remember that movie Memento from a decade or more ago? It was that movie that had black and white scenes that proceeded chronologically, and it was interspersed with color scenes that proceeded in reverse order. And these two scenes meet at the end of the movie, and you feel like you're having an aneurysm. And that's exactly the way this song ends. It's insane that they're able to play three different time signatures simultaneously. Danny Carey's holding down two of those himself. And still make it musical and melodic. And they don't compromise the integrity of the song. I mean, it's mind-blowing. And, you know, I'm sitting here finishing the drum notation, and this by far is the biggest challenge I've ever had in front of me for learning the drum part. So like I said, I've made it almost halfway through the song on the real drum kit, but the major hurdle by far is still ahead of me because I haven't even gotten into the breakdown in all of these Swiss Army triplet polyrhythms. So wish me luck.